travelling woman, a lot of people thought they had second sight or they had some witchcraft or banavision. Well, it wasn't. They had foresight. They knew the people that they were going to. And this old traveller woman had come to this village not too far away from here, and she knew the house that she was going into, and sat down in the usual felicitations. And the woman of the house was sitting with her daughter, who was heavily pregnant, but they seemed to be sad. Yeah, and she said, "Oh, what's the trouble in the house today?" And she said, the mother said, "Oh, she's my daughter's expecting a baby," and she mentioned who it was to. They got married, and she said, "She's 10 and a half months. She's all this week's past her time, and there's no sign of the baby coming." "Oh," says the traveller woman, "tell me a little bit more." "Oh," she said, "well, there was ill feeling because her husband had been betrothed or engaged to one at the other end of the village, and he had let her down," the phrase that was used. "And he married my daughter," and she said, "there's no sign of this baby coming, and we're all concerned." So the traveller woman didn't say anything more, had her cup of tea or salt, which she was selling, and she paid a visit to the house at the end of the village. I didn't say where it is. I guess when she went in there, the mother and daughter were sitting there, and they were knitting. The daughter was knitting furiously by the fire. So she went in, and as was common, they brought news from one village to the other. "Oh, where have you come from?" "Oh," she said, "we've just arrived, and have you been to many houses yet?" "Oh, I've been to your neighbours, and I've been at such and such," and she mentioned the one at the other end of the village. And she said, "Did you hear the good news?" And the Kalyar said, "What good news is that?" "Oh," she said, "she had a baby this morning." And the girl got up furiously. "I told you that it wouldn't work, Mother, I told you." And she threw the knitting into the fires, galavantirachna, sparks and flames. And the traveller woman said, And she had a cup of tea, and she walked back to the other end of the village, and here's the girl in labour with her baby. Whatever they had, or whatever they were doing, it was preventing the baby from being born.
So my piece was kind of the first main painting project that we did, and it was kind of all about how I felt quite nostalgic about my childhood and how I kind of had a lot of objects that were quite symbolic of that, and they were all kind of just things that I used to play with that had just really become kind of discarded around my room. And I quite liked exploring how kind of the relationship between objects that were just like random things like marbles and then plastic toys and then just things like skulls. There was the little plastic tiger, which I remember I used to have a whole set of plastic animals, and that was kind of one of the only ones that I saved, and I used to kind of play with them all the time, and it was quite interesting how it just, to me, had just become like a room ornament really, and how it was really forgotten about, and I quite liked its potential to tell kind of a story but to also just tell nothing, you know what I mean? And there were kind of objects in there that I included just because they kind of had the potential to be interpreted as anything. Like I included the bird skull and the moth to kind of deal with time and how kind of fragile I think it felt.
And you can see it is an old, old story. So my rehearsed me ha large linea to prendorish and is gemapdish a lhul shanski alachken. I guess I tor of larg say good. Sinski alach who would me hen it is shen. I guess when I have a gemma even shet stodi a hirsht. Agus se stodi man se ska han a horro, a mis mwynach. So, mae yw'n y bodoch o fesio o fafwydioch o hirsht, as chan lach gen i yw sga han gydioch a glasach o. Agus hwn y gyffer an y dy y charyd. Os chan rhaid sy'n ei halw di i fan, a mae gen i'ch gres mynd i'ch gredio laf o fan y dosiach. Hwst e o fwf. As eis yn ched eis y sga han gydioch o'r te o fwf, fe mi gyrra mync i eisiau hwst e. Ha mi clyniol gydioch na drwts y bu i ni wedi ws. E, gyrwyd gymaniau o'nwch. Agus so glwy eisiau chael na hwf gydwf sydd yn ei ffalas y sient, fel sy'n stopau mach a hengys a chyd yn mynd rwyd sy'n sgaan. A gynfforeg y gyrra hyn y fe chynchgyn. Och, am y dyn as y charyd, sy'n sgaan a sy'n siw hyn a hawf chynchgyn, sy'n sy'n charyd i hwf gos gyfynchgyn di eisiau chas y sgaan. Agus, wel, wel, as y bod o'ch nal sy'n hyn i wyntwch. Fe mi ffer eisiau o hwrs gach eich gom fen. So, a hwgelis sga han gach ei gafen y hirsht agos hwrste hwrste cedd as eis yn dirwyd lwch a siaw mi gach ei ywgwyd cyw sialog yma bri a so cyw cedd eis eid y sga han a chanaeth gyda torri fai cedd eid y chwl agos hwrste chan mi ffeich yn sian cyw'n dweud mae gwrs eich alad as eis yn agos cyw nŵr sy'n so Hún verði skara hans hættjans, liki jæsas, húki lístjas, húrsti. Ó, vel, að þessi, maður sé sérna hæði að græta, þessi filosofal af að glasa hó, að glan á makkert stads gynna gala glasa hó til.
My artwork is mainly sculpture, because I'm a tradesman by trade. So I find it easy to do, and I've selected that one because I was watching a Viking film and I thought, this is quite smart. So I've taken the armour as the steel, as the lead, and basically opened it up at the back to make it look like the sculptor's going to Valhalla. That's why, hence the lights. I've done painting, which I've never done in my life, apart from house painting. So I found that quite interesting, actually. So I've done a hell of a lot of stuff. You know, it's been a good course, to be honest. So it's also good for... I'd say anybody with PTSD like I have in the army, it's very good to go on. So I've not had an episode for a year, so I'm dreading leaving though. I'm going to have to find the next course to do. So probably dressmaking or something, I don't know. We'll find something to do. Tailoring, that's what I'll do next. Just keep my mind occupied. I just get fed up of seeing the same mundane thing in life, so I'll just try to tune up somebody's roof a bit and make it look stand out. Whereas people on Harris say, which number? Because we don't have numbers here, it's just that McKenzie's out in the bottom and you think, who? So if you can see, if they say the pattern on the roof, but I think when I've slated Harris, everybody will have the pattern on the roof.
I was paddling my feet by the loch when I met a Gallus cove. He offered me a string of trout to sit by him a while. He laid his head upon my lap and charmed me with his patter. I blithely kissed his salty lips. It didn't seem to matter. Then I ran my fingers through his hair and roasted with dread and shame, for I seen the green gore about his boots and silky dulse on his mane. My heart was sair. He slept so lound while I cut my plaidie, then I eased myself to mark a distance through my bonny laddie.
Safely and continued to work in films and TV. There is now a huge sculpture of the amazing bear Hercules at Langish Woodland.
Fionn Le Roux, who's mentioned in all the books about Rona. Sometimes it's called North Rona, but its real name is Rona. It's 45 miles north of the Butte of Lewis, and it's fairly close to Sulashgir, where the cougars are hunted, traditionally by Ness folk. So I had no knowledge of this because my father had died, but anyway, when I was doing my genealogy, I came across this fact, and Fionn Le Roux is one of the families in around about 1850s. The shepherd was sent out with his family for about 7 or 8 years to live on Rona, to grow crops, gather seal oil and stuff like that. They had no boat. They were left out on the island. They had sheep and they had a cow, possibly a horse even. But there's no landing place on Rona. There's no pier. There's no landing place. The only time you can get on or off it is in a flat calm, and you have to step onto a rock. Likewise, when they were taking sheep, to take the sheep back to Ness or whatever it had to be done. So I know knowledge of this. So Fionn Le Roux was one of the families sent out to Rona, and his eldest son was my great-great-great-grandfather. So when I discovered this through the genealogy hobby, I discovered a distant cousin in Skye. And then, lo and behold, the Islands Book Trust was putting on a conference on Rona, the topic of Rona, and my husband Archie was a counsellor, so I went up from here, Uist up to Ness, and we both went to it. And it was a wonderful weekend, learning about the island and so on, and actually on the Saturday, it was flat calm. And we got a trip out to Rona from the port of Ness. Absolutely wonderful. So I now have photographs of me standing on Rona in the house where my great-great-great-grandfather lived.
The folklore, the landscape, the links between the folklore and the landscape here. The winter, sitting reading folk tales and just being totally inspired by the elements outside and the link with that and the tales that I'm reading. So in every folk tale around the world you get different characters that are similar. You always get a trickster, you always get an old woman, you always get a young maiden. And you can relate that to your own life, and they might not be physical characters, the trickster might be yourself. I think about the Hebridean culture is that it wasn't patriarchal particularly. It was more matriarchal like.
So betide every word there is a story. Galavin gulish ne kuri chaper de vami dule vamin belch na bigi sik ma vaher jechu kuchir na nach jech. She used to sing that one for me, and I would ask her, what happened, what happened? This young boy was drowned. My great granny would sing Yulin, Yulin, Yulin monig, Yulin Kotrin litunya get behos a cloy mulen in small all of these are lost never hear them anymore.